All right, I got another motivational video for you. At the tech shop, we have a water jet. So here's a video of the water jet. And it's in slow motion. That is aluminum, but the plate that's holding it down on the right is steel. And yes, it will cut through that much steel. It'll cut through 6 inches of steel, 8 inches of granite. And then, I think that's the end of the video. You hear it where it's that blast. What it is, it's high pressure water that has garnet that is embedded in it. So it's just like sandpaper being run through. And that garnet, of course, cuts through the metal, the granite. I mean, so it'll do steel, it'll do granite, it'll do glass.
Flesh.
In fact, it's funny that you say it does flesh because there's these medical warnings that are nearby there. And then there's this in case of, because it's just like a hypodermic needle and you'll end up injecting garnet and very dirty, nasty water into your body too. So there's these, if this happens, take this card with you with the hospital so they know what you've just been injected with. But it's another tool, and it's there at the tech shop. It's on the ramp. It's outdoors, and this thing's really a large size. I mean, it'll take a 4x8 sheet of something in there easily. Again, another motivation for CNC, because then you can go out there and just, you know, cut granite just for the fun of it. I did get asked a question on 123D, how to start with existing design. So what you can do is you can do an import of SVG as sketch or solid. But I believe what you have to do is sign in. And there is where you can start using other designs, but I think that's in the premium. So let's go back to the PowerPoint here. I believe that's what this was about. So here, the free version, it's a non-commercial use, free apps for 3D design and 3D printing, free projects and 3D models, unlimited cloud storage. I apologize. I believe there is a way. You go to the website or go to the blog, support forums. But there are ways where you can bring in existing 3D designs into here and then start modifying them. And I think that's one of the places that I forgot to kind of tell you about is Instructables. This is a really, really neat website. I'm telling you, I am so happy that Al Gore created the internet.
Al Gore really had a lot to do with creating the internet, and I'm really annoyed that people make fun of that.
Okay, and I agree. He did have a lot to do with that. So this Instructables here is literally where you create a course on how to make something, and you post it online. So there's, you know, literally, you know, how to bake cookies, how to make leather. You see here all these different, and there's, if you go pro with a 1-2-3D design, you get a pro at Instructables. Another place to go in, I believe it's a MakerBot, is Thingiverse. And this is just a crazy, crazy site here. And the thing of it is, you could probably type, what Thingiverse is literally a repository where people have uploaded their projects, and you can download their projects and then 3D print them. So like here, now I notice there's no young ladies in the room here, but young ladies and will have a blast with CADing and 3D printing, and they can print all of the furniture for their dollhouse. And I've also seen designs for dolls, printing out dolls. And I mean, they're articulated, you can move their arms and stuff like that. It is mind-boggling, the depth of things. Like I said, if you can imagine it, it's probably already there. And as silly as it may sound on there. So here we are at Thingiverse, and let's just for the fun of it type in ham radio. And here's a dipole antenna support. Ooh, here's a handy thing, a CB ham radio mic holder. And here's a Wyndham antenna on that. Here's a remote face. Here's where a holder for your HT. So see, you guys are already behind. There's the ARRL keychain. So, you know, you guys got to get with the ball, because you got to sit there and upload, you know, some, you know, whatever your useless thing is up there too. Ah, we got to get working on it. That's why I got to train you guys, right? This is kind of cool. Look at this. This is like a crystal set on there. So you wind the coil on there, and there's your antenna. And then you got your Morse code on there. It's just, you know, it's crazy. You can just get on the internet like here and just keep digging and digging and digging. That's why I say at some point you got to say, you know, say that's enough. Go to the shop and start making chips. Okay. All right. So I hope that answers that gentleman's question. There's a lot out there to start with. Autodesk does a great job of also having things that you can start with as well. So you're not starting from scratch, okay? And then I think there was another question about sketches or something. John Ackerman, is it a question you had during the break?
Well, it's just about if you start from a two-dimensional object, how do you make it 3D?
Yeah, so So John's question was, you know, if you start two-dimensional and you go 3D. So let me start a new sketch here. Don't save. As I'll just refresh, you can either come in here to a primitive and select a cylinder. Notice what happens to the cylinder. The base snaps to the grid. All right. You can click on it and you've made a cylinder. Or you can go up here to sketch. You can say, make a circle, select the grid, select your center, go out, click, enter. Now you have to go up here to construct, select extrude, select the circle, and then extrude it. So you see, there was two ways I could make a cylinder. Same is true for a square, because I could use a rectangle. And the extrude is perhaps the most powerful tool, and it's the one you'll use the most. And I'm going to show you when we move to the professional software, because you can do something completely freeform here. So let's do a freeform drawing. So let's say, for the fun of it, we're going to do the Tapper logo. So let's do the Tapper logo. Now notice what I'm doing is I selected the line tool again. Here I'm selecting it a third time. But notice I'm going over here to my line. Notice it turns green. I click on it, and what I'm doing is I'm sticking with that drawing, and I'm continuing it, hitting enter. So you see it took me, enter. What? Enter. No, I don't want you. All right, so there's our Tapper logo. Doesn't look like much, looks like a stick figure. But now I'll go here and say modify, and I'm sorry, construct, extrude. Then I'll select, it says it wants a 2D shape or face to extrude. So it's not liking the line as a thing to extrude. So that's kind of interesting. So let's go back and let's start over, shall we? Now we learned something. So we still want to make that Tapper logo. So let's look at it from the top. Okay. So what we need to do now, let's go back to that polyline. Start down here. Click. I select on the grid. Click. Let's go up. Let's go left. Let's go up. Let's go right. Down. So what I end up doing here is making, just using the line to make the logo. So this is a great example. Thanks for this idea. So then we come down here and then close it. Okay? Well, it's kind of a square looking. So now what we can go up here and do our modify, but we can go over here to our sketch where it says sketch a fillet. And the way we do that is we select the line and this line, and there's our fillet. So I'm going to zoom in, and I can change the fillet. See? And then I got to go back up here and select it again. And so, you know, swore cactuses are kind of asymmetrical, so you can, you don't have to be perfect, so hit enter. The other thing you can do is I'll delete that line there. Now it's not a closed item, but let's try another tool here. So let's use this 3 points arc. I'm going to select it. Come on down. Notice it says select sketch or plane. So there's our plane. I'm going to click here. Follow the instructions. Click to specify endpoint of arc. There. Click. And then the third is click to specify point of arc. So we can give it a bulbous nose or we're just going to, there. And we're done. See how quick that was? So you get used to using these tools. You can draw something. You can delete something. You can go in here and sketch something. Boom, 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 boom. Green, we're done. Okay? So there you go. Now what about here? So this is where the leg of it. Now I can still use the sketch fillet. Let's try. Say again. I'm going to try it again. So here we go. Sketch a fillet. Click to edit sketch. Boom. I've clicked it. Select one. Select the other. And then I decide just where it's going. Okay. And that's kind of cool. I like that. And so let's go back up here. Let's select the sketch. You know, if you're new to it, just follow the instructions. There you go. So how's that look? Right? Pretty cool, right? Now that you got your 2D sketch and it's an enclosed sketch, now we can go up here. Let's hit the home key. Let's do the construct. Here's the extrude. Huh. Still not letting me select it. It's not closed somewhere. All right, so let's escape. Exactly. So something's not closed somewhere. And that's kind of funny because what did it not, where is it not closed? Now in the Autodesk Inventor, there's actually a command that'll close it for you, but I don't know what it is here. That stinks. Well, let's try this. I don't know. Let's see if we can group it. Construct. No, it's not going to let me do that. Yeah, that's what I was afraid of, is I didn't really want to... It's going to... There it is. Now it'll let me select it. There was something about me doing those radiuses. But thank you for that, but... It drives home a good point. See here how when I hover over it, it highlights the whole drawing, and it has to be enclosed. And if you can't do that, then I can't go up here. Let me go back to the home, and then I'm going to do construct. Now I can select it, and now I can raise it. All right, now not all is lost. So now that we've extruded it, we still have tools. But now they're modify. And here is that fillet. So let's select fillet. And again, zoom in, navigate, find that edge that you want to be a fillet, and then change it. See that? You're never... lost. You're never stuck. You may be confused all to heck, but there's always a way. You might feel that there isn't, but there's always a way. Okay? And it just, honest to goodness, it takes practice. Okay? Oh, come on. I had that just perfect the way I wanted it. And then enter. So let's go back here to our home key. You know, we can keep working on that, and before you know it, we're going to have the whole Tapper logo. Let's do text. And we are going to put T, and we'll make the height 20 millimeters, and we need... Give me a T, give me an A, give me a P. See how I'm doing that? I got to go up here to the text box, put in the text, choose the font, choose the size, okay.
Can it just type it in and just rotate the text?
You know, it probably can, but I'm going to chicken out and say I'm doing this for illustrative purposes to hide my ignorance.
A higher purpose.
All right, now what can I do with these letters? So now I can, you know, select them. So now let's go back to construct, and I can shift click. And there we go. Enter. And now let's look at it from the top. Oh, this is kind of an interesting thing, too. This is what's known as perspective. Notice when we're looking down on it, this would be reality. You know, this is how our eyes look. And if I shift to the left, I'm sorry, let me look at the top. If I look to the left, notice how it's perspective. See that? Yeah, that's almost, that'll give you motion sickness, you know. Now, there is orthographic. Thank you very much. There it is, orthographic. Thank you. So now it's orthographic. I'm looking straight down on it, and it looks like it's flat. But when I rotate, it's not flat. Now, 123D defaults to perspective. Honestly, orthographic in my head is better when you're doing this, because then you get these relative distances. Otherwise, you get that, you know, looking down on the city type effect. All right? And, you know, we can go and 3D print this. Now, what's kind of cool is, let's see if we have material cactus on here. Let's say we want to make it out of gold. Okay. Didn't quite make it out of gold, did it? I've got gold selected. Well, what this is here is it's not so much the color as it's allowing you to change the tint of it. And then you can go in here and change it to different materials and different colors. It helps you visualize it, but when you print it, it's not in that color. When you set it up to print, you've got to put the correct filament in on that, okay? The changing the material in the drawing is purely for rendering and visualization. When you export it, there is no command that says gold or wood on that, as much as you'd like for it. Now, when we get to Star Trek Next Generation, and you can say tea, Earl Grey hot, you guys are supposed to laugh at that. Okay.
Well, some of us did.
Okay. But you know, we're not too far from that, you know, if you think about it.
Bring it further.
Yeah. Okay, so there we go. So what I'd like to do is, we've got about an hour and 20 minutes left, so I kind of want to segue into the advanced. And the reason for doing that is comparing and contrasting. What can you do with the free? What can you do with the advance? And then I want to kind of give you some examples. Now, the best way to learn is to have something that you're really excited in that you would like very much to make, like the Tapper logo, or you want to make a keychain, or you want to make some jewelry. So pick a project. It's funny, I'm in the tech shop, I'm seeing people go through the classes, and they go, I don't know what to make. And I'm like, you've got to be kidding me. So here, let me show you some of the things I can suggest for you. Here's the things I want to make, and I don't have time to do it. And you're just like, I don't know what to make.
Well, the difference is you're a square head. She's a
wizard. Yeah, there is that. Okay, so let's get back to the PowerPoint. And this is the topic of advance. All right, so there's now things are going to kind of get mixed, but what I'm trying to do is, as I mentioned, compare and contrast, give you an example. Those are the two things. All right, so here we go. The program I learned at Tech Shop is Autodesk Inventor. It's a competitor product to SolidWorks, so you'll often hear a lot of people talk about SolidWorks, and it, believe me, SolidWorks is a phenomenal program, but because I'm a member of the Tech Shop and I took the class there, I learned Autodesk Inventor. But I do believe that still, if you use the program, it has a lot of the same concepts. If I were to sit down on lynda.com or YouTube and I had a copy of SolidWorks, I could more than likely learn SolidWorks. Okay. So Autodesk Inventor, you basically go to Autodesk and ask for Inventor. Now, lynda.com also has a training course. It's 8 hours long. The person who gives it, John Helfen, I kind of Googled his name, found out he is an employee at Autodesk. So he's a professional trainer, and so he gives the course that's on lynda.com, and it's phenomenal. It really is phenomenal. Does an outstanding job of it. And as I was struggling with Inventor, I would go back to whatever the thing I'm struggling with and just watch it over and over again. Now, I bring up this really neat device that's called the Space Navigator. Now, for all of you that own Flex Radio 6700s, yeah, I got one chuckle out of that one. You may already own this device, okay? But it is, I don't own one, but I saw one of the fellows at the tech shop have one, and I'll tell you what, he could go up and down and scroll and zoom and all that, all from just this one knob. And it's kind of a scary knob, because if we had this sort of thing on a radio, I wonder what we could do with it. Okay. These start out about $99 and work up. But there's one thing about CADing is, you know, you're drawing a line, drawing another line, drawing another line. I mean, after 1,000 lines, you've got one tiny part. Save it, go on to the next one, and then before you can assemble the whole thing that you're going to do. So this is a big, big, big time saver. So if you're really going to get into 3D in a big way, or you're just a gadget freak, you know, this is a great gadget. So you need a project, right? You just don't know what it is you want to make, and I would make a suggestion of one of Elmer Volberg's engines. So Elmer Volberg wrote this book called Elmer's Engines, and I don't know how many small stationary engines that are in there, but they're from very simple to really complex. And if you find a copy of this book at a yard sale for, you know, less than $1,000, buy it, because you've got a bargain. So what's happened is they did scan his book and put it on the internet. So if we go to Elmer's Engines, we find this John-Tom website. Here's a picture of Mr. Elmer Volberg. He's passed away. And then here's the plans. So what they did is, and I'm going to use the Beam Engine plan number 4 here, and you download it, and it's a PDF, free to download, and here you go. Here are the plans. And here's the article. Here's the little Beam Engine, okay? Tells you these are really quick instructions. They're not detailed instructions. But, I mean, just really good detail here in these drawings. I mean, sufficient detail. It tells you, you know, the beam's made out of aluminum. This linkage is made out of brass. Kind of gives you a photo. And you can go to YouTube and type in Elmer's Engines, and all kinds of people have videos of how they made the engine or whatnot. So there's tons and tons and tons of information out there. So I'm a flange head, which is to say mechanical engineer, whatever you want to do, and I love mechanical things. So now, if you say that you have the knack, remember, the knack is all things electrical and mechanical. Well, I'm trying to be specific here, as we always like to be. So if you're just electrical only or mechanical only, you cannot have the knack. Now, what I did is, and there's a purpose for me bringing up number 24 here. So let's see, I want to go back to my PowerPoint. So then, here we go. So this is in the PowerPoint. And now here's what I did, is to learn Autodesk Inventor, I CADed the whole doggone engine. So what you do is, here's the flywheel. Whoops. That's another project. Here's the flywheel. Okay? So here's the flywheel, here's the diameter, here's the little diameters that are to be part of the spokes, and here it is. Here is the flywheel. Now this is an Autodesk Inventor, and if I go over here to Shaded with Edges, Shaded with Edges, there's a lot of different ways to view it here, because if I just do Shaded, and then there's a particular light, but here's what's really cool. I can do Wireframe. So in other words, I'm going to really wow you with Autodesk Inventor, because there's just all these different modes that are available with you, and it's like using Microsoft Word. You only know 10 commands out of the thousands that are there. But once you learn the thousands, there's like kind of opens up a whole new world for you. All right, so let's do Wireframe with Hidden Edges. So now you can see the dotted lines. And let's go in here with Visible Edges. So it looks like it's just a regular drawing. And then here you can go monochrome. So now it's not any particular material. I said it was brass, so it looked like it was brass. Here you can make it look like it's a watercolor. And then the ultimate here is you can go in here and go into realistic. And you're supposed to render it. Where's the rendering? Well, it's not free. And oh, yeah, let me get up here to where I'm going to render it. So let me go on to View and Visual Style. Why is it not? Oh, here we go, Ray Tracing. I'm enabling Ray Tracing. Now, notice this little pop-up box that says Interactive. I've talked with people that if you've got a computer that's got some huge computing power and huge computer graphics, this interactive mode, when you move it, it's almost instantaneous. So notice I'm going to zoom in on it, and notice it has to re-render it. But it renders it in, 4 seconds? Here, 1, 2, 3, 4. So if you have a really high-end graphics machine, this is practically instantaneous. All right, now I just have a laptop here, so I'm going to select best, and let's watch it. And this is like watching chrome bumpers rust.
Is this available for Mac and Windows?
Yes. So the question is it available for Mac and Windows? And the answer is yes.
Not Linux.
What's the cost?
Okay, so the cost is a subscription fee. So I think it's upwards of $10,000 a year, something like that. Now, I think what we'll have to do is go to the website and verify that, because I might be wrong. Now, why you sit there and say, okay, Mr. Bible, why do you have a copy of this? It's being a member of the tech shop. So the tech shop, when you go to the tech shop, one of the things I forgot to tell you is they have all kinds of computers there loaded with every program, and every one of the programs is the pro version, and they're all available for commercial use.
Is this the pay-as-you-go plan?
This one here, this is the educational version.
I'm on their website. It says pay-as-you-go monthly.
Okay, so it's only 3,000, 36?
$3,065
a year. Okay, subscription fee if you get the annual. Now, what do you get with the annual? Of course, each year you get a refresh of the program. What I'm running here is the 2014 version. I was online checking the 2016 versions online right now. So if you had a subscription, what you would do is every year you could get the upgrade. And I managed to upgrade from 13 to 14, and there was some changes in the commands, which was a bit frustrating. So once I settled on 14 and I got a lot of drawings done on 14, I was like, nope, I'm not upgrading. I'm going to settle with these for now. Now, at some point, you want to upgrade. What had happened was when I took all my files that were written in the earlier version, it went through a conversion process and created an old files folder and put my old files in there.
And it was also for a professional version. This regular inventor is 1,890 a year.
Okay, regular inventor is 1,800 a year. Okay. So, you know, for the serious hobbyist, or join a place that you can get, you know, the subscription as part of your subscription to the place, like a tech shop. Okay, so now you've noticed this has been running for a mere 195 seconds, and it still has 88% more to go, and so it'll take some time. So I'm gonna go ahead. I'll click on good. Good actually goes a lot more faster. And what's kind of cool up here is you can select your reflections, you can set them, you can select your shadows, you can select the lights that you're going to have, and you can select a background. So it's really kind of cool in the sense of doing the rendering. So let me go back to shaded with edges. Go ahead.
Really what you do, when you just want to make it, you really don't need all that rendering.
When you're doing the actual modeling, you don't need the rendering. That is correct. Just go ahead and use your favorite, your preferred shaded, or I like the shaded with edges because it emphasizes the edges. This particular flywheel is a great example because look over here on the left. This is called the browser over here. And what's really cool here is that for every event, it's logged over here on the left. So you see this thing that's called end of part. If I grab that and drag this up to between extrusion 1 and 2, it shows you what I started with. So I started with just this one extrusion. Now let's take a look. Let's dive into the extrusion. There's a sketch associated with it, and this is my sketch. So I can double click on it, go into the sketch mode. I drew this sketch. I drew two circles, and notice that the outer circle is 2.5 inches in diameter, and then notice the inner circle is 1/4 inch in diameter. Good suggestion, pay attention to radius and diameter. For those of you that need a refresher course, diameter is 2 times radius. Believe me, you will make that mistake. All right, so let's go back to Elmer's drawing here. Notice that Elmer, he lists the flywheel, here it is, 2.5 inches in diameter, and then notice this hole in here is 1/4 inch. Okay, so start with that, end your sketch, do the extruding. Then the next extrusion, is actually on the other side. There we go. So the next extrusion was actually making this depression. So what you do is you make a sketch on top of the disc, and notice that this outer circle's 2 inches, this inner circle's 1/2 inch. So let's go back to the drawing. Notice here that 2 inches is this inner circle, and then 1/2 inch is this outer circle. So you look at these drawings, and you have to kind of ask yourself, so how do I make that happen in Inventor? And there's probably 6 ways to do it. So this was my most naive way of doing it. So what I did then is drew it, and then extruded it, but actually I went in, which cut it. So then that made this part of the disc. Now you can probably guess extrusion 3 was doing the same thing on the other side. There you go. So now, if we were to go here and view it as a wireframe, you're going to see that now I have this thinner disc on the inside. See that? And a hub. Now what I need is the spokes. All right, so let's go back home. Next one. There's one spoke. There's the other spoke. Now, why did I do the spoke separately? Because this is one of the first projects I ever did, and I did not know about the command that I can select, and I can do a multiply, which is this pattern device up here. So I only needed to draw it once, select it, select pattern, it'll go boom, 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 and make it for me. I learned that later in my life, and I've been much happier for it. So there is the wheel, okay? The cool thing then is I go up here to, let's see. Yeah, so what happened is, that's the other thing too is, I didn't tell my wife about it, but I went down to Fry's Electronics and I bought me the largest monitor I could possibly buy. It was an LG 25 by 9. It was those long, thin ones. Because
$500.
No, it was $1,000. Yeah. No, I never.
The 4K version.
Yeah.
It was. It was the. Yeah, it is. It is. Because the you're right. The five there's that same one that's not 4K. And I'm like, yeah, I need the 4K. Anyway, so this thing's like 36 inches in diagonal, right? And when you're CADing, you just want so much space in front of you. So
says Steve, buy her $1,000 worth of jewelry.
Oh, no. I am, no. Knowing my wife, she's a very, and we're on videotape here, and she's just not here to hit me, but she's a very high maintenance woman, so.
Whoa.
And I might say very well worth it. Thank you very much, dear.
I hope you pass that.
So the
there's a charge for editing.
It's got your funding.
The so of course then this window is quite open and you can see all of the ribbon that's on the top. So here you can see there's a little double arrow, and then I can drop this down. Look at these different materials you can choose from. So naturally I selected brass, but what if you wanted to make it out of copper? There it is. Now it's made out of copper. You know, now we just need an export command, and then shazam, there's a copper wheel right in front of you, you know.
Arriving at your front door.
Well, you know, you want to still go up there and say T. Earl Grey hot.
Could you make it out of tube materials?
You could. If you want to make it out of two materials, you've got two drawings, and then you have to assemble them. Okay? So thank you for that leading question, because this, as you'll notice, is just the flywheel. So when you're doing Inventor, now this is not to say 1-2-3D. Okay, now 1-2-3D, you'll create that same flywheel. And you can select a material. And then you're going to go up here and do File, Save, and say Flywheel. And then you're going to start all over again, brand new, and you're going to decide, okay, I've done the flywheel, now let's do the column, all right? And you're going to CAD the column. So let's go here to, and here's my files. I have, let's see, how many files do I have? 47 files here And in Inventor, the file extension IPT stands for part. All right, so then the nice thing about Elmer's engines is he says, okay, this is called the column. So when I name the file, what do you think I'm going to call it? The column. So here is the column. What's nice is in the lower left, I get a preview of it. Once I double click it, there's my column. So here's the column that I modeled. Now, as you can imagine, you can see all these different shapes and sizes on it, and every one of them was a different action. So I can show you. I can take the end of part, go all the way back up here, and notice origin here. So the cool thing about Inventor is it actually, and I'll turn them on. Inventor actually starts with a three-dimensional plane. That's it. So there's the XYZ plane.